What are you gonna do with your life?
I'm gonna get what I want.
I want to break free. I want to break free. I want to break free from your lies. You're so self-satisfied, I don't need you. I've got to break free. God knows. God knows I want to break free.
Fuck it. Do it live.
Fuck it. Jackson and I and everybody, we're going to do it live.
All right, yeah, we're doing it live. Fuck it.
Fuck it, we'll do it live.
Fuck it.
Tonight on Stumbling Down History Road, we're going to be talking about Vlad the Impaler. I am Jackson.
I am Garrett.
I'm D.
And before we really get into it again, I got to do the shout out for the 250 subscriber free shirt giveaway. We got two different shirts going on right now.
Yeah, these things are sick. You guys are definitely going to want one.
I just got this shirt.
He's a cool shit.
Yeah, he wasn't invited. Yeah. He just kind of showed up today.
He didn't get the memo.
Do you have your 500 subscriber bullshit that you want to do?
Yeah. You know, 500 subscribers, do a Pornhub challenge with the Playboys, old celebrity ones. I guess I can't do the holiday one now since Christmas is over, but still got the issue for next year.
You could really press that issue.
I can press that issue with that issue.
Ba-dum-tsh.
So
don't forget, Vanna White.
Vanna White. Let's do it. Naked pictures of B. Arthur.
So, Vlad the Impaler.
That, you think I think I wouldn't be like fucking advertising that shit?
So, Vlad the Impaler.
No, that's from
Vlad Dracula.
Vlad Dracula the Third.
Dracor.
Not Dracor.
His dad, Dracula.
It's Dracul.
It is Dracul. Because it's. Ia is the.
Dracula.
Is the romantic way of saying, like, son of.
Yes.
So Vlad Dracul the Second and Vlad Dracula the Third, the Impaler.
Tepes.
Yeah.
Which is technically an epithet, or yeah, not the actual. Because a lot of people use Tepes as the name. It is actually just Vlad Dracula. They kind of had a similar thing where they did like the first name, last type thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's
Now, we said that there's Dracul and Dracula. Obviously, it's his dad. There's Vlad the First somewhere. Vlad Dracula, the second one's son, the Impaler. But he also kind of like ties in with other stuff, you know? Allegedly. Because we're saying Dracula a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm?
Boy, you guys are so engaging.
Sorry, well, just trying to figure something out real quick.
Yeah, we're just trying to figure out where you're going with this, my guy.
Well, I just want to talk about the fact that, like, a lot of people consider Vlad the Impaler to be, like, the reason why Bram Stoker wrote Vlad Dracula.
Not even fucking close, but all right.
A lot of people consider it.
A lot of people do, and it's mostly just in the fact that it's the name, and he uses Transylvania.
Well, which no, wasn't there even was
Transylvania at the time. It was Wallachia.
Yeah, but there was.
Well, there was a Transylvania at the time.
There was.
There was no, a Transylvania in Stoker's also time, yes. I'm talking about when Dracula was alive.
No, there was a. No, there was a Transylvania.
But there was also supposedly
The Transylvanian region of Wallachia, which is actually the mountain range itself. Transylvania's always kind of been a thing. It's just the country itself before it was Transylvania was overall just Wallachia.
Yes. So there was apparently what I read about how the Dracula story came about was Bram Stoker read a sort of transcript from a noble, so to speak, or somebody who was a consulate to Wallachia and was basically telling the story in the transcript, which Bram Stoker got his hands on, and then he modeled the story after that, adopting the term Dracula from the name. That's
which
the,
originally meant part of the Order of the Dragon.
The Dragon, well, which his father was known as the Dragon because his father was a part of the
Order of the Dragon.
Order of the Dragon, which was
Sigismund was part of that who basically founded it in, like, Scandinavia area.
His father, but
the
his
Order
father
of the Dragon was
a Catholic.
No. Orthodox.
Yes.
They were Eastern / Russian Orthodox Knights.
I understand
order.
You're Jewish, but there is a big difference to these people.
Yeah.
They were an Orthodox order of knights and lords, whose mission was to basically just keep evil out of the lands of Orthodoxy, which usually just meant fucking Muslims.
Turks,
Muslims. Yeah, you know.
Ottoman Empire, the Byzantine Empire.
That whole hullabaloo. Well, Byzantine was
different. Of Catholic, but a different type of Christianity.
But by then we were already well into their crusades and stuff. The Byzantine had more or less fallen. It was like the Ottoman Empire.
Yes, the Ottomans were huge at this point. They were probably the largest empire at the moment.
More or less, yes.
So Vlad Dracula was born sometime between 1428 and 1431. Most people guess right at 1431. Because it's really hard to get an accurate pinpoint. They don't know his mother. They just know that he's Vlad II's kid. They know that Rada is the younger brother. And there was one that I can't pronounce that starts with an M. Was the older brother that died with Vlad II. But we'll talk about that. So Wallachia is located in between basically like modern day Turkey, I guess.
Yeah.
And Hungary. And
it's more or less where Romania is now.
Yeah. It was a huge, like, fought after area because you had the Saxons, you had the Byzantines, you had the Ottomans. They were all looking at trying to get any edge in land over each other. And that's where Wallachia was kind of just like, okay, I'm here. So Vlad II was the, how do you pronounce it, with a ba? Barmo?
Voyager,
maybe? Voyager. We're going to mispronounce a lot of fucking shit. Yeah.
Voyodi. He was recognized as Voyodi of Wallachia.
Yes.
Basically, more or less like the regent prince in charge.
Yeah, like so the duke, the prince, the king, the chieftain, whatever you want to call it.
They were basically the ruler of the land of that area of the land. And back there was many different lands, many different territories, and each territory or land.
Well, Wallachia it's known for having a lot of different, like, oh, look, now I'm the ruler. Now I'm the ruler.
Yeah. Like
it just means prince or duke.
Basically, back in that time, it was pretty much whoever can muster up a bigger army to overtake
and
the other
some,
army.
And had some, quote-unquote, noble claim.
Yeah.
Yeah, usually it was like, I'm of some sort of noble, and then I got financed by the right people and whatnot. Yeah. And yeah.
But it was like, oh, look, I'm the half-brother of this. I'm the cousin of this. Now I have claim. The medieval times were very Game of Thrones, to put it in this area. Very incestuous, very like, oh, I'm the brother of this to the brother of this to the cousin of this. So that means I have a stake at the throne. It was weird. It's a weird time. People died, man.
Oh,
a
yeah.
lot. So the Ottoman Empire was led by Sultan Murad I during Vlad Dracul's birth. And so he was being pressured by the Hungarians. Vlad II was being pressured by the Hungarians to go against the Ottomans and to war against them. And the Ottomans were trying to use him to pressure the Hungarians. And it just kind of...
So what had happened was they were... The second. Yeah,
He had to turn over his kids in order to not die to the Ottomans.
So there was basically a ruse to get him to go to the the emperor or wherever to their palace.
Sultan.
Sultan
Murad.
To basically say, I am with you. My people are with you. We're going to fight.
We're going to help you out.
We're going to be a part of your team, basically, for lack of a better
word. So this way we can get one over on Hungary.
But then, in turn... Yeah, so basically, in turn, the Sultan turned around and imprisoned Vlad II.
The third.
Vlad III.
And the second. Well,
no, he was already. He was doing his own thing. That was Vlad's father.
Yeah, but it was his. So it was they Vlad, took the three of them. All three of them went. Radu,
yes,
Vlad so the second, and Vlad the first, third went.
Yes,
they imprisoned first, all the three of them, and then they let Vlad the second go, but he had to keep his kids there.
Yeah,
this way they would have some political power over Vlad and Wallachia in order to be like, hey,
it's a very common.
It was very common in medieval times. You do anything we don't appreciate, we're gonna kill your kids.
Yeah,
more or less.
So.
Vlad basically learned, like, a whole...
He learned torture.
So...
He was trained in military... Well, first off, he also received, like, actual learning and military training and stuff.
But he was
of noble blood.
He was of some noble blood, so therefore the Ottomans actually treated him as, like, a real person, not just, okay, you're a slave.
Well, they also
I'm not saying he wasn't a slave, but they, like, hey, man, we're going to get you some education, we're going to get you some learning, like, we're going to treat you almost like a real person.
His brother actually ended up carrying a lot of favor with the Sultan and becoming one of his right-hand men, too.
Mehmed?
Yeah. No. Yeah, what? His brother, Radu?
Radu, but he ended up getting a lot of favor with Sultan Mehmed.
Yes.
So,
which is Murad's son.
Yes.
Yeah. So, during this whole time, Vlad III and... what the heck is it? Radu, the fucking ugly.
Handsome.
Jackson and I have been arguing about this all day.
Handsome is fucking subjective.
There's
no photos, there's no paintings of Radu. So therefore, he's like, oh, he's probably just like a fucking 5 out of 10. So meanwhile, Ivan the Terrible wasn't that bad.
No, because
Ivan the Terrible was just kind of mid.
No, that's like this stupid argument to put out there, because what I'm saying is, all right, if you look back and you watch videos of all this stuff happening, and when they do all these recanting of everything, there's pictures of basically most of these people.
They're not pictures, they're paintings.
Painting. It's a picture is a painting, Jackson. Stop fucking being so literal. It's ridiculous. Mm-hmm. It's the same shit. It's the same fucking thing. There is a fucking image of them. However you want to picture it, it's a picture of that person. So that's there. But there's no image of supposedly the most handsome person in all the land. But they have pictures of fucking the fucking... Yeah, but that's not him. That's a fucking rendering.
Okay. That's still what he may or possibly look
like. May or may not have looked like, yeah. I could say that anybody may or may not have looked like
anything. But we could say the same thing about Vlad the Impaler, and there's paintings of him. He may or may not have looked like that.
But there's paintings that somebody painted of him. They sat down and they painted him. They painted all these people. I'm saying, so if this person is that handsome, the other one that they showed was a redhead guy.
That's the Sultan.
So you're going to tell me that... So I'm telling you, this guy was probably a fucking 5, and you probably needed 10 drinks for him to be a fucking handsome. But anyway, I digress. So they...
Radu the Handsome.
They let go Vlad the Second, and he goes back to Wallachia. And him and one of his other sons are ruling, but during that time they kill.
So the Hungarians actually end up kill. The Ottomans end up.
It was the Hungarians.
It was the Hungarians. Yeah,
basically what happened a lot of like Hungarian aristocrats set him and his brother up for assassination.
Yeah,
and then when that happened, the Ottomans are like, all right, you know what, Vlad. Here's the thing. You're going to be chill with us, more or less, but, you know, we're going to let you go back, take your revenge, and kind of take over, but...
Well, yes and no, because there was, again, a lot of different times with it. Vlad the Impaler took charge of Wallachia 3 separate times.
Yes.
And I think his longest stint was, like, 6 years. The first one was only, like, 3 months, because he got ousted by other... we said the word before with a B. Vurads? Voyads? Voyads?
Whatever.
He got ousted by another Voyad. Again, this was a very warring time. This was a lot of, oh, look, I have claim to the stake because I'm cousin of this. I'm that. And so there was like Stephen the Third and Dan the Good and shit like that. Like, there was all sorts of different people that were just like, oh, look, the aristocrats don't like you. The tradesmen don't like you. We're going to oust you. But he really only had like 3-4 months on his first time. And then he got sent, was it to Moldavia? Did he flee to?
Yeah.
He fled to Moldavia during the first one. Or was that the second one? Because I think that was the second one after his second year, his second term? I think he went back to Ottoman.
I don't remember. It's been a while. These things kind of blur together with history.
Been a while.
But either way, the first term.
Felt someone like you.
The first term did not last very long at all.
No.
And then, again, he got ousted. He got sent to, I think he fled
first
to
First time he went to the Ottomans.
It was the Ottomans? Okay, so he went back to the Ottomans.
He went to the Ottoman Islands. Hung out in the Ottoman Islands.
You ever have an Ottoman? They're weird. Hmm? You ever have an Ottoman?
Christmas Ottoman?
No, not an Ottoman. But an Ottoman.
Like the footrest from in front of a chair.
Yeah, Ottoman. Yeah.
Sometimes they're like actually somewhat comfy chairs if you just want to sit on them. But sometimes it's just like, why not just get a real lazy boy?
Sometimes they're like hollow and you can put shit in them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Loud cars.
That's actually a truck.
Oh, it's even more dickish then.
But Vlad goes back to the Ottomans. And this is right around, I think, 1450? 14, late 1450s. He's looking it up. He's looking it up, people.
It was about 1450s. Yeah, late 1448.
Apparently. Okay, so a little earlier than that.
For the first time.
And he got usurped by Steve, Dan, John.
You know what's crazy? Because there's a lot of, like...
There's John Hunyadi from Hungary, who actually plays a pretty good role with him, which is weird because the Hungarians killed his dad. No, maybe it was Moldavia. I don't remember. Medieval times, man. They're fucking all over the place. But the main takeaway of this is don't fucking get staked.
Okay.
Okay. So one of the things going back to, because this was his captivity and his treatment in captivity is kind of, and then the events after the captivity is kind of what led to and really spawned on the whole impaler and the whole...
Him being seen as one of the most evil men of all history.
Yes.
So, which is weird because
him as a hero.
Yes. Yes. And, you know, and that's why I was trying to look it up because
he brought law and order to the place with an iron fist.
Yeah, but
literally.
He brought law and order.
He also got rid of a lot of the peasants, whether it was through murder or by dividing. Actual peasants he killed a lot of. But if you were just of the lower class but not quite a peasant, you were still working, he gave you land.
Oh, yeah.
So he was loved by any low class, not peasant. He was loved by tradesmen because he fucking hated any foreign tradesmen.
Yeah. He was like a medieval Donald Trump. There you go. Minus the impaling of people. But he was very much for his people, very much for keeping the work in with his people. Not so much the whole killing the fucking
peasants. At the time, that makes sense. Nowadays, it's a little bit more...
But just the whole very, nationalistic, trying to keep jobs in the country.
Yes, he was very nationalistic. I'm not opposed to saying that.
But some would... And,
I think 10,000 people would be opposed to that.
And then also, people in Romania love Vlad the Impaler, but he's pulverizing because most other people fucking hate him. And the same thing with Trump.
Pulverizing?
He did say pulverizing.
Yeah, he's a pulverizing figure. Polarizing, yeah. Polarizing.
Just gonna keep rolling there. Anyway.
Fuck it. Take three.
Polarizing.
But
words are difficult.
The thing is...
Like any dictator, like any...
There's a few different ways you could, look at him. There's, the actual historical facts. There's the kind of folkloric, almost mysticism around him, and then there's the legacy that he left on in terms of popular culture.
We also have to take into account that a lot of the writings of him were done by the Germanic people.
Yes.
And they hated him because he was not for Hungary. He was not for the Ottoman Empire. The Sultan hated him. The Sultan Mehmed hated him, and he grew up with him. Him, Radu, and Mehmed all grew up together, effectively, because he was a political prisoner by Murad, his dad.
We've already said that, yeah.
Yeah, but Radu ended up being loved by the Ottomans and loving the culture. He converted into Islam. There's rumors that I've read in multiple different accounts that he was a lover of Mehmed. Yeah. And they were...
Yeah, but there are also accounts that Vlad the Impaler was raped by him.
It was more Mehmed... the ones that I read were more Mehmed raped Radu, and he eventually kind of became Stockholm Syndrome-ish.
I mean, I could see that a sexual assault did happen to Vlad the Impaler while over there, whether or not it was the Sultan himself or, say... one of his many various captive army teachers or whoever.
They were all tortured. They were still...
It was not cool to grow up in basically what was Janissary. Well, they were basically raised partially as Janissaries, which are a type of troop that was infamous at the time.
Famous, he's infamous.
Think kind of like what the Immortals were in 300. They were kind of a similar concept to the Janissaries at the time. Like, very much dedicated troop, like, shock troop almost type thing.
Yeah.
It's, Persians and Ottomans seem to have a thing for that.
It's... We digress. So where was I at this point? Does anybody know where I was? I don't know where I was.
We're... kind of just trying to summarize his life more large,
so,
which is a little awkward.
Yeah. Vlad ends up getting help from the Ottomans in order to take back over Wallachia. He ends up taking power again in the 1460s, I think it is? Late 1450s?
Yeah, about that.
And with this is where he really grows into his infamy. Because this is his longest stint at it. And he has multiple interactions with the Sultan where he's like, hey,
the
you got
Saxons too.
The Saxons, the Hungarians, the Pope Pius, because Pope Pius II was going around like, hey, we got to start another crusade because the Ottomans just kicked out the Byzantine Empire and took over Constantinople. And this is the first time that Muslims have ever taken over Constantinople. So they were like, hey, we want that back. That is where Mehmed really got his, like, big dick energy, because he was the first person to ever take over, the first Muslim to ever take over Constantinople and make it fall. He was a, at the time, brilliant military leader, and he was known as Mehmed the Conqueror. And Vlad the Impaler was kind of just like, fuck you. You guys did all this shit to me when I was growing up. Fuck you. I don't give a damn. I'm not bowing to anybody. There's different stories of when the Ottoman Empire sent emissaries or enclaves, whatever the fuck they were called back then, where it was like, hey, so this is what's going on. The Sultan wants money, and you're going to give to him. Cool? We'll back you up, but like, we're cool? You're going to give him money? And he was like, yo, why didn't you take off your hat? It's a sign of respect to...
Oh, yeah, the, this story. Okay, yeah.
Nailed the hat to
the, okay, to so the what Wallachian... happened was,
yeah, so they sent over some... they weren't supposed to remove their headwear.
It's part of their religion that they cannot remove their headwear.
Well, it's also part of their... It was part of their position, too, because these were... what's the word I'm looking for?
Emissaries,
yeah.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Yeah, so he's like, why didn't you remove your headwear? And like, well...
It's a sign of respect in Wallachia that you have to remove your headwear to the Wallachian prince.
Yeah, and like, well, we can't. It's part of our... So, yeah, he has them taken away and has the fucking...
He was like, okay, bet. Now it's permanent. And fucking drove nails into their hats, into their head.
Yes.
Or I guess turbans? Would it be a turban at the time?
Well,
their headwear.
Yes, their headwear.
And he just, he did not give a fuck. He would, so there's a story of when the Sultan was, again, I don't think it was the same one, but it was a different emissary where the Sultan was like, hey, go collect money. And it was, he just killed the guy and sent him a burned down like three different Ottoman towns and was like, hey, so I killed 23,000 of your people. This is not a sign of peace. We're at war now.
Yeah, he very much basically went to war with the Ottomans.
Which is a bold fucking move.
Cotton, but let's see if it pays off.
The Ottomans were, like, the fucking rulers of that area.
Yeah, but he was... like
He was a military genius.
He was an absolute military... like, he did some crazy lowbrow, below-the-belt stuff. Like, he used to send, like, anybody that was sick...
Bubonic plague, leprosy.
Leprosy. Yeah. He would send them out and be like, I don't care if you die. Infect everyone, as many of the soldiers as you possibly can.
Go to the towns. Make some friends.
Yeah.
Make out.
Yeah. He would, and then, so.
He would do that. He would do a scorched earth. General fucking Patton would be proud of this man.
Wait, scorched earth. You're thinking Sherman. Burning Sherman.
General Sherman would be fucking proud of this man.
Good old Burning Sherman.
Where he used a scorched earth tactic. They were like, oh, well, we know that the Ottomans are coming into this town because we have intel. So everybody,
the whole fucking thing to the ground.
Everybody, next town over, burn it down, burn down the crops, and let's leave some bodies in the water so this way they don't have anything to drink.
Yep.
And he would poison the fucking water.
He would poison, and that's. But he would. So he knew. He learned. He spoke five or six different languages.
He was smart.
Yes.
So.
Like I said, very well educated. Nobles were well educated.
He would basically go to the soldiers of the Turk soldiers. And he would basically talk to them in Turk. He would wear the Turkish fucking.
Hey, he was a fucking spy. Homeboy was James Bond.
He was spying for himself. He would do these covert spy missions, and like him and like his top fucking leaders, they would go. And they would pretend like they were Turkish soldiers to go find where the generals were and the fucking where all the to figure out what was going on and just get intel. And then they would go and use that intel and then they would just fucking savagely destroy anybody that came in.
Yeah,
and
so there's a story of 20,000 Ottoman soldiers were sent into a town and he put them all on a fucking stake because the Impaler. And he put the two highest rankers on, like, the head stake. It's accounted on pretty much every version I've seen of anything to do with Vlad the Impaler.
He put it alongside the road leading into the town. And when the
Takashmene?
Targaviste.
Targaviste. And as it was, like, Ottomans three road, fucking kilometers long. So over a mile and a half long.
And 2 miles
of thousands wide. Of bodies on stakes. Some of them still possibly alive at the time.
And some of them
because you didn't die instantly.
And some of them were being eaten. And the Sultan, because the Sultan was personally, Sultan Mehmed, was personally leading the shit, was like,
fuck this, I'm turning around.
Yeah, Do we continue? But you know I'm impressed. Crazy?
So they continue. Most of the army was fucking devastated.
Fucking.
But they had so many people that they were able to make it and fucking still take over. And still basically.
Well, that.
At first.
So it was a combination of that and before he even got there, before he got past the Danu River. As we said, Vlad was such a fucking G spy. He went with like. 5,000, so he had a 15,000 estimated troop army, and he split them up in half. And he took about 7,000 men, and he infiltrated the Sultan's army and killed 15,000 fucking men and lost 5,000 in a raid at night trying to personally kill the fucking Sultan because he was James Bonding this shit, being like, yo, which one's the Sultan's tent? Yeah? Cool. In fucking fluent Turkish and being all dressed up as a Turkish officer, they weren't allowed at. So I keep saying Turkish, but it's the Ottomans. The Ottoman Empire, the Sultan, he didn't let his guys run free when they were set up at camp at night because he didn't want to cause a stir. He didn't want them to lose their nerves in case they got invaded and shit like that, which coincidentally, they ended up getting invaded and kind of lost three times as many men, but that's neither here nor there. And that was with only half of it, because the other half of Vlad the Impaler's fucking troops, they chickened out, but he missed the chance to kill the Sultan in his tent.
Seems very common with medieval warlords, because
they were all leaders of themselves.
Well, there's the infamous story about Yugisai Kenshin and Takeda Shingen.
But you said feudal.
You're not even going to ask about that?
Well, you said feudal, and that triggered like a little thing in my mind.
Yeah, but
so I want to say that Vlad was very against like the feudal system. He wanted just like a centralized ruler, and he didn't want to have the different chieftains. He wanted to power up the trade merchants and basically almost run a semi-democracy type bullshit where people would be like...
Almost like the medieval version of libertarianism?
Yeah, kind of. You were saying feudal Japan? Sorry.
Oh, so there's this weird stumble, but there's an old tale about Yugisada Kenshin, his medieval Japanese daimyo, and Takeda Shingen. During one of their battles... fucking Yugisari got lost somehow on his horseback, ended up in front of Takeda Shingen himself, tried to take a swipe at him with his fan, and with his sword, and Shingen blocked it with his war fan. And then they tried to exchange blows a few times before they got kind of forced apart by, like, retainers and stuff.
Hmm.
But, yeah, no shit. So he accidentally fucking wanders into the guy's fucking home base, tries to take a shot at him, misses, and then, you know, ends up having to fuck off. So it's happened more than once.
Yeah, yeah. If you were a general, a leader at some point of that time, you had to have fucking balls.
Oh, yeah.
Or you
oh,
would
yeah.
be stepped on.
Oh, for sure.
You were very much in front lines, too, at the time.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, because this was... It was all
or whatever weird tactics that you had.
It was all about respect. You know, like, they had to get the respect of the people underneath them. And if you're not going to go out there and do that shit yourself, they're going to
be
like...
Or fear in Impeller's case.
Yeah, well, I mean, how... Else do you, if you're not out there doing these things, how are they going to fear you? Why are they going to fear you? They're going to be like, you won't even fucking kill somebody. I'm killing them for you. Why would I fear you? I'll just kill you. But they're afraid of getting fucking killed themselves by the person... Which is hence the fear, or them doing the same shit.
Oh, they're playing the Warhammer Gambit. Which faction is that again?
Where it runs on fear?
Well, no, or if you don't listen to me, I kill you.
I mean, pretty much any dictatorship.
Yeah.
I was thinking like the Get Death Corps or whatever, maybe?
That's a lot of different factions in Warhammer.
It's been a shout out to our Warhammer episode. Anyway.
Warhammer 1 and 2 episode.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But,
Vlad was very boyish, and I don't want to say boyish. He was very bolsterous and very of his own, because there was when he took over the second time, he took over and he fucking hand-to-hand combated, I think it was Stephen III. I don't remember who it was. I keep saying different names.
He just fucked up a lot.
But he had the chance to have him and his men fight the guy that was... The chieftain,
the prince. Just say the prince.
The prince.
It's essentially
and he
prince.
Just, he was like, nah, man, we're going to one-on-one this. And he fucking kills him.
Like, does anybody else kind of like, I don't know, this is a digression or whatever, but like, sure. We got Johns and we got Steves and we got stuff like that, but then we're talking about like,
fucking, Vlad.
Vlad is Mumed. Vlad is still a pretty popular name. Not in Russia. There's a lot of Vlads in Russia. Like, that's a pretty popular name. Vlad is... That's a pretty popular name.
One of the hosts on the radio station calls himself Vlad. I don't know if it's his actual name or not.
But then we're talking about, like, Ramuds and, like, fucking, like, all these, like, actual...
Radu.
Radu, whatever. Like, sorry. Like, you're super literal. I get it. We're on a podcast, but, like, you're super literal.
Radu is an actual name, too, but whatever.
I'm just saying, like...
But, like, it's just, like...
Pretty sure I've heard that name before.
There's such dichotomies in, like, the fucking names. Like, certain ones still stuck around. Like, we still got Johns and Steves, but, like, we still got Vlads. Hate to tell you, Jackson, but there's still Vlads. But you don't really see a Radu much. You don't really see a...
It's because you're not in that section of the world.
Correct.
Yeah. But, I mean, we have a lot of people that have come from all over the world that are here. We are come across a lot of names all over when you read things, when you see
things.
Well,
a lot of times they also immigrate with a Americanized name.
Yeah.
Because a lot of times people will have something that they just don't think that American people could pronounce, and they're like, yeah, I'm John. I'm Frank.
One of the few scenes I've ever seen of the fucking The Sopranos was during the last season. It was one of the characters bitching about how they Americanized their name at Ellis Island. And he thought it was offensive how they fucked it up or whatever it was.
I mean, yeah, they've been doing that for
interesting scene.
It's because eventually Christianity won out and was like, hey, we got this nice fancy America. We got this nice fancy Europe.
No, I mean, a lot of people hid their names because they changed their names because they had to hide their where they were coming from.
Well, yeah, that too, but whatever, anyway. But, where were we?
We were talking about Vlad and his war efforts.
Yeah, I mean, so, the thing was, yeah, when it came to, like, actually fighting and, like, but the problem was he ruffled everybody's fucking feathers.
He wasn't exactly for anybody. He wanted Wallachia to be the next Ottoman Empire. He thought that it was, and he was, great enough to be a ruler above his means. And unfortunately, there was, Hungary, there was the Saxons, there was the Ottomans. Like, he was in the wrong place.
He was in a small...
He had a lot of ambition for... His eyes were too big for his stomach when he came.
Exactly. That's exactly what it is. He didn't have the people behind him to make his dreams come true.
I mean, he literally came into power by killing an ass-whacking nobles as revenge for his...
Which time?
Which, just to speak of...
The first time with the Hungarians that killed his father.
Yeah.
So, and which goes to speak of him giving back to his people, the ones that, like, were on his side. He killed all these nobles, and he gave that money and that land, like Jackson said, he would give that to the people to help...
So long as they weren't actually, like, beggars, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he did kill any criminals. He killed a lot of old people. He killed a lot of the fucking... Most of the people that were sick. Basically, killing them by sending them to war.
If you weren't useful, he killed you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But because... And that's kind of that, like, the master race kind of thing. Like, we're going to build the master race, almost like that Hitler...
I wouldn't say it's, like, a master race thing. I'd say it's more just a...
You're basically essentially creating a master race because you're getting rid of the weaker people of your race. So I was thinking a stronger efficiency thing.
Yeah, it wasn't a race thing with them.
When it came with the Germans, yeah, it was like, but that was definitely racist. This was more just, hey,
if you can't pull your own weight, we're going to kill you.
Or, hey, if you break the law,
We're going to kill you.
Yeah. And that's not really a racist thing
because, you know, that's just him. That's just efficiency.
Maybe master race, again, you guys love to take things extremely super literal.
They're both rooted in two very different ideologies.
He was trying to weed out anybody that wasn't useful to him, leaving him with the useful people, making him have a class of people, making him have a group of people that were hopefully in his eyes powerful enough to take over.
Well,
he would also take in
useful Hungarians, useful Ottoman refugees. Like, he would take in people that were useful. And so I'm trying to draw the line of racism versus nationalistic.
So like I said, race, master race, like, wasn't the perfect term for it, but he was still trying to get
two
rid of
very sim like opposite sides of the same coin. It's the same coin, but both sides, this different sides of it is what we're basically getting at here.
So that's why I conceded.
Anyway,
using
whatever.
The word race was not the right term.
Carrying on. So he's. Yeah, he basically gets into power more than once. The first time...
Three times. The last time it was like a month.
Well, the last time what happened was his first wife killed herself.
Yes.
Yeah. She saw that there was impending danger.
No, what had happened was he was at war at the time, and she received false news that he had died in combat, and that
I heard that they weren't able to actually go on record to show who the first wife was, but they knew of the second wife, and that's what I think you're thinking of, where she was like, hey, I'd rather be fish food than die to the Ottomans.
And that's the second wife, sorry.
That's the second wife. Yeah. That's a different thing. The first wife was known to have killed herself because she thought that Vlad had died in combat and the city was about to get invaded. So she was both despondent of her lost love and despondent of the fact that she, you know, was going to become basically a political captive, possibly. The second time was, fuck this shit, everything's going to shit, I'm out. And even then, it's kind of debated whether or not she did or not, because she was... This was another thing that caused him part of his downfall. She was a Catholic, which caused... He actually converted from the Orthodoxy, losing him a lot of favor from his people because of this, which is part of the reason why he didn't last as long, because he lost a lot of favor from his people, because he converted to Catholicism.
Catholics.
Yeah, because he was trying to get the help from the church.
He wanted Pope Pius II.
And so, yeah, he married into Catholicism and stuff, and this... And
guess what?
It didn't fucking work.
Nobody other than Vlad wanted to help Pope Pius II on a second crusade, or whichever one they were on that fucking year. There was a lot of crusades.
This was well into it. These were some of the last crusades, basically.
There was a lot of crusades.
They were settling out. Because, this was by the 1400s, the Crusades were basically more or less settled out by then. Because they started during the 1100s, I want to say.
Yeah. But they were still going, because, again, Pope Pius was like, hey.
They were still trying, but at that time it was basically like,
all right, we're fucking done here. It wasn't the Crusades. It was just like, yeah, we're going on a crusade.
Hey, we're going to try again and see if we can get any bullshit this time. And then... You know, the Ottomans lasted up till basically World War fucking One.
Yeah, they were around forever.
Yeah. So that's like another 400 plus years.
What's a fun baseball fact about that? Because it was the Chicago Cubs, right?
I have no idea.
The Chicago Cubs didn't win a World Series up until... So they won one recently, right? You're a semi-baseball fan.
Sometime.
I want to say within the last like 15 years they won one. And they had such a long streak that this is, you know, one of the most loved facts on the internet. Same thing with like, hey, look, Star Wars aired and French were still using guillotines.
Yep. The last execution by guillotine was the same year Star Wars premiered. And
it was France.
Christopher Lee was in attendance for it.
Yeah.
Believe it or not. Yeah. Young Christopher Lee was in attendance at the last execution of a guillotine.
But I was talking more about, I think it was like 1914 Chicago Cubs. Last World Series before the most recent one, and it was the Ottoman Empire was still a power when the Chicago Cubs last won the World Series.
Well, have you seen that one D&D kind of meme going around where samurai, pirates, cowboys, and gentlemen thieves, Victorian era? Yeah.
That's a fun fact that I didn't mention. Allegedly, during one of the invades of the Ottoman Empire, Vlad was able to ambush the Ottoman army, and this is one of the first recorded uses of gunpowder for warfare.
Yes.
So that's a fun fact. He was very ahead of his time.
Gunpowder...
Gunpowder, as brought up by our firearms episode...
I think, really burst onto the scene in warfare until the 1500s, I think.
Yeah, yeah, they didn't really start, like, using it.
Well, except for the Chinese, but that's a different story.
Yeah, they were using it more for rockets as opposed to bullets.
No, the Chinese were using it for warfare going back before that.
Again, but it was more for rockets, rocket-prepared arrows as opposed to bullets, yeah.
But that's because they were using their version of gunpowder. This was the different type that we were more kind of made for. Boom, boom, not...
Yeah.
Whatever.
Check out our firearms episode. We go over some stuff.
It's chemically different, whatever. Anyway. Yeah. Similar, but different. Whatever.
You seem upset.
I'm not upset. No. I don't know what you guys are talking about.
So, Whatever.
Do you have any fun Vlad facts?
No.
Involving, like, his rule, his treatment of
thieves,
things like this?
Start actually getting into the whole vampire thing or no?
Well, I was going to talk a little bit more about, like, how there was a story of... So it was a Saxon trader came in to Wallachia, and he was told to leave his cart and all of his goods in the town square because, allegedly, this is how strict he was on fucking thievery and whatnot. He was like, no, just leave it in the square. It'll be fine. It'll be fine. Nothing will happen.
Oh, yeah. You could leave a whole pound of gold in the middle of the square, and it'll be there the next... He bragged he could leave a gold chalice filled with wine in the middle of the town square, and
there's records of a drop missing
because he was so tough on thievery.
No. So there's what I read was there's records of the gold chalice in not Tagavishta, but another like major city of his, and they left it in the town square, and anybody was free to drink from it, but it was not to leave the circle, like X circle, if it was caught. Missing from there, then they would go on the whole hunt for it. But the Saxon trader, he left his cart in there. All of his goods were there, but he was missing, I think it was 1,500 dirats.
He was missing like a certain amount of something. I think I remember this.
1,400 dirats or something like that, which the equivalency of nowadays is like $500,000.
Yeah,
because there was somebody did a conversion on something that I saw where it was in 1912 a dirat was worth like $2 and then base it on inflation and bullshit like this. So take it for what you want.
We'll come back to that. Whatever, it doesn't matter. Yeah. He lost some money is what we're saying.
And he told Vlad, hey, nothing is missing except for this. And he was like, oh, go check again, go check again. And he had his people put the 14,000 or 1,401 dirat in there. And by the time that the Saxon trader comes back to be, hey, everything was there, I found it. But the weird thing is there was an extra dirat. He was already punishing the thief, the actual thief, and... Allegedly, the actual thief. I don't know how they could actually test that that quickly. Like, I'm sure there's ways.
I mean, in towns like that, with that amount of money, people are going to talk real quick. Yeah. Especially if it's been, like, a whole night.
Yeah. And if you're as feared as Vlad the fucking Impaler, known for having dinner next to screaming bodies on stakes.
Allegedly, that was never really 100% confirmed if it was a thing or not. Especially the whole dipping the bread in blood thing. Blood yeah.
We'll talk about the...
We'll get to that.
We will talk about that.
Anyway.
But...
He was like...
There was 14,001. There was an extra one. And it was like, oh... Well, it's a good thing that you reported that extra one. Because if you didn't, I was going to call you a thief and have you murdered.
Pretty much, yeah.
Like, that is how fucking weird this law is and how tough on crime and how for trades but not for trades. And, oh, my God. He would put taxation on anyone from Saxons and he would just be like, all right, yeah, I mean, if you want to trade in here, that's fine. But we're going to take a large fucking tax and all sorts of shit. He was... You know how they came up with the taxation, no taxation without representation, throwing the Boston Tea Party? Yeah, that would have been something that he had done to him. But it's... Which,
thinking of, if I have to, you know, the whole... If you have a job at 16, I think you should be able to vote. If you're paying taxes federally with, like, a tax...
I agree with you on that statement, and that is a slightly different statement.
If you are
paying taxes on things, and you are a kid... You should have some buoyancy in some type of voting something. However, where do we draw the voting line based off of mental awareness and mental age, like your maturity?
Look, if you're a citizen of the United States and not a felon, I suppose, and are paying and have paid taxes to the government federally and state, you should have be able to say and vote. And I think even mentally handicapped people should have a say and vote.
Well, the whole reason I'm saying that is because there's tons of kids that go out and buy like Pokemon cards and shit like that, and there's tax on that. At what point do we draw the
sales tax? Is a different thing. I'm talking about work tax.
But they're still being taxed without being able to be properly represented, which is where I'm like, okay, where do we draw the line?
Well, that's look, sales tax in and of itself is its own inherent bullshit. But
this is not about that.
I'm saying if you like, because you could get a job at 14 in some places. If you're 14, paying fucking.
You would know this one. Who was the most likely? Elizabeth Barkley?
Bathory.
Elizabeth Bathory. So there was a Charles Bathory that was actually somebody who helped aid Vlad the Impaler in his third attempt of regaining power, I think it was?
Yeah, so they actually...
Are they related?
They are very distant related, yes, because she was a Hungarian noble. But they were very, very distantly related.
Yeah, I don't really know any of this stuff.
But they never actually interacted, I think, because her bloodline does go extends back and forth. It's not just her. Like, she actually married into the noble house. So this could have been one of her husband's, like...
Cousins or something.
Ancestors, cousin. But, yeah, no, Elizabeth Bathory, she...
She's known for allegedly bathing in blood and being yet another influence of vampiric lore. There is a lot of potential vampire bullshit that goes on with Transylvania, Romania, Wallachia, Hungary, the whole Germanic.
It's literally all over the world. There's a vampire. There's basically an almost
That one definitely has like a... Okay, Vlad the Impaler, Elizabeth Bathory.
Yeah, she lived after him because he was 1400. She was mid to late 1500s.
Yes, I wasn't saying that they would have met.
It was one of her ancestors. Yeah. But, well, they were fighting in the Crusades for a long time, the Bathory family anyway.
Yeah.
In fact, her husband basically was almost never there half because he was in one of the Crusades half the time or off doing his own fighting in war half the time anyway. But, oh.
Vlad is known for being potentially more destructive and terroristic in terms of fear to any potential people than, like, potentially even Caligula. I've heard comparisons to that, and I don't know if anybody knows who Caligula is, but...
Good film.
He wasn't exactly a nice guy.
No.
Caligula was not a nice man. If you maintained any form of power, you very much were typically not a nice man to anyone that was your enemy.
Or sometimes even your own people.
Yeah.
Actually, a lot of times even your own people. It apparently be like that.
Well, you have to maintain fear and power somehow, right? Don't need revolts.
No.
But got any jokes for us? You all right, bud?
Yeah, I'm good.
You
just here.
All right. I mean, if you want this stuff, I'm repacking this in a minute.
But, have you seen Bram Stoker's Dracula with Keanu Reeves?
No.
Really? It's a good film.
I did see Interview with the Vampire.
That's an okay film.
I ask because we're going to talk a little bit about Bram Stoker and the Vlad Dracula vampire lore a little bit. We're gonna touch upon that a little bit. And, well...
What we do in Shadows?
No, I've been meaning to, actually, because...
The TV show or the movie?
Both. I haven't seen either or, really.
You said TV show, though?
Yeah.
Have you seen the movie?
I haven't seen
the movie. Is better, from what I've been told. I saw the first episode of... Oh, what we do in the shadows. But I've been told that the movie is better.
Well, the movie in itself is just a movie. The TV show is, I think, now like 4 or 5 seasons going.
Yeah, correct.
Yeah, it's been...
But the movie came out first and actually got them greenlit for a TV show because of how good it was.
But I've heard both are really good because there's a running bit in the TV show where like celebrities will do cameos pastiching like the vampires they played and stuff. Like Wesley Snipes is a day-walking vampire. And they all fucking hate him for it. which I think is amusing.
Yeah, I was asking because Keanu Reeves is one of our drivers here. At least it's his dad.
What?
Paulie.
Paulie's dad is Keanu. What?
Oh, you know. He's part Keanu Reeves, part Cheech Marin, part...
Oh, the voice bit. Okay, because he talks late. Okay.
Yeah. Well, it's not just the voice bit. It's how he acts.
Yeah. Yeah. But,
Was it Cheech or Tommy Chong?
Another Chong.
I don't...
Whatever.
It's been a long day.
Fucking... But, so... I guess, yeah, we'll get in kind of into the vampire stuff then, eh? Because... So, the thing with Dracula was...
This was in the 1900s. Or 19th century?
1800s,
18th century.
Wrote that
Bram Stoker.
19th century. That's the way.
No, he wrote it late. He wrote it...
It was like 1846?
No, he wrote it later than that because Bram Stoker's Widow was alive into the 1900s, my dude. He wrote it in the 1880s, 1890s.
In the 19th century. Bram Stoker wrote Vlad Dracul, loosely based off of Dracula.
Yeah, 1847 to... Whatever. Anyway. So, the thing was... He drew inspiration from a lot of sources. It's not just Dracula. I mean, yeah, it's Transylvania.
It was the
name.
It was the Germanic area.
But, I mean, the whole thing of itself was he drew inspiration from a lot of other sources. Like, there's an old Irish vampire myth that he drew from. He drew from Elizabeth Bathory. He drew from Varney the Vampire. He drew from Carmella.
Did you say Barney the Vampire?
Varney. Varney the Vampire was a London-based vampire story that was published, I want to say, 50-ish years before the publication of Dracula. And it's weird. I've never actually read the story, but it's a vampire tale. Carmella was a book was before Dracula too, and that's about a lesbian vampire. He drew from that. It's like I said, there was an old Irish vampire, the Agincourt, I think it was called.
Agrocrag.
But
the story that I read was that I'm rereading it now, but it was through a diplomat, like I was saying, that was worked for the Ottoman Empire, and this guy Armin Vambery, I don't fucking know. So he was a
Armin Vambery.
Vambery, I don't know. Yeah. So he was a Hungarian Jew, and he was a diplomat, and he worked for the Ottoman Empire, and he basically wrote tales of the Dracula stories of.
Vlad the Impaler.
Of Vlad the Impaler.
The and atrocities.
Then Bram Stoker met this gentleman, and the gentleman told these stories to him, who then turned them into part of his, I guess, inspiration for the character.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean,
but the overall, like, you know, vampires themselves and. You know, even the Count himself, like, he draws from not just the one guy, though.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
So, it's... Yeah. It's... The association between the two is... I mean, at this point, it's, you know, basically just... But at the time, it wasn't technically supposed to be the... You know, he was he, and it was just cool name... This is the area I was going with because it sounds, you know, mysterious, and you don't know what the fuck's going on there, and then just, you know, but, yeah, it's a whole fucking...
It led into a big debacle.
I mean, from what I understand, like, you know, they over in Romania now, they embrace the shit out of it because it's a huge tourism thing.
But, oh, yeah, I'm sure, yeah.
You know...
I've seen through YouTube, I've seen tours of one of Vlad the Impaler's castle.
Are you talking about the
Boris Vista, I think? Not Targis Veste?
You're talking about the old... It's like a big hill. It's kind of like...
Yeah, yeah, it's put into a hill, and it's very like, hey, there's traps on traps on traps.
Yeah, I know the one you're talking about. So there's like the actual like Dracula's Castle Hotel tourist attraction thing, and then there are like actual Dracula... Not like
castle... Vlad the Impaler Dracula, not Dracula...
And those are, like, historic, actual, like...
This was a real castle
like fortresses, yeah.
For war.
Yeah. Like, they weren't even really castles. They were fortresses, basically. Like, military bases that he...
Vlad the Impaler loved building up fucking fortresses and
military bases, yeah. But, yeah, the actual, like, the one you go to, like, the tourist trap, though, with, like, the coffins and shit, that's a ahistoric thing that was built very recently to be a tourist trap. But, yeah, you can actually, like, see some of, like, his actual, you know, ruins and places that he, like, had been and stuff.
We didn't talk about the fact that, like, nobody really knows where his body is and how he died.
Well, they said he was beheaded and that they sent his head to...
So...
There's a couple different potential rumors.
Yes.
One of them, one that I've heard was that he was in a hunting accident and never recovered, and therefore he wasn't able to make it to a fight against the Ottomans. And they just recovered his body. They never recovered his body. One of them was that he was beheaded by an assassin through the Ottoman Empire. One was that he... I think it was the Hungarian assassin. One was that he lost in a fight to the Ottoman Empire. Like, he just died in, well, battle with them. Because it was, again, a warring time, and everybody wanted Wallachia because it was a great fucking port. There was all sorts of good shit there.
The most used one is usually that he was captured by the Ottomans and then executed.
Yeah.
And his body...
His head was preserved in honey.
Yes.
You've heard that? His head was preserved in honey?
The three different accounts that I found were that he was beheaded and that they put his head at the top of the...
A stake?
On a stake on one of the main fences leading into the emperor's...
The Sultan's palace. Just be like, yo, fuck off, bitch.
Because it was a trophy.
As it should be.
Then his actual body itself was buried. However, his body was either stolen or exhumed and then reburied elsewhere where he would have preferred it is the usual one they go with.
I've also heard that he actually fled the fight because he knew that he was losing and made it to Italy as like a refugee and was buried in an Italian church.
There is that rumor too.
There's the one where they found him in, what was it, Boris Vista at the bottom of that, and there was like the Vlad the Impaler's crown with purple and gold fucking robes and shit like that, and that was exhumed and it got stolen while it was being studied to verify whether it was his.
Yeah. I mean, we are talking about stuff that happened in the you know, early to mid 1400s. So
late 1400s by then.
By then, yeah. Well, I mean, by the time he died, but I'm saying even just the accounts of most of his life were stuff that is just stories passed on in tablatures and in fucking journals and stuff.
You know what they say?
Who knows?
History is written by the winners.
Yeah.
So...
Yeah, because the dead are not there. The losers are usually dead and not there to fucking write it. Or don't want to tell their fucking what happened because they're embarrassed.
Exactly. So in Romania, he's a hero. Anywhere else in the area, he's a fucking evil person. And if you're over here in America with us, he's
a fucking vampire, apparently.
He is a vampire.
Same thing with Japan.
Yeah, Japan's weird.
Which is another weird thing because the Fate Steer is bringing around to our fucking multiverse here.
Sonic Chew.
Like, they weirdly acknowledged it by having him be, at first, like, he's a noble spirit, which is, like, the dead people come back to life to be fight, bat, whatever, anyway. But he starts off being able to just summon spikes out of the ground to impale. And so long as he's in the Romanian area, he's basically unstoppable because he's worshipped there. So he's like... All right, I got home turf advantage here, so I have, you know, more power this way. Is this a video game?
Anime.
Kind of, sort of, yeah.
Anime slash video games. I think they made a couple.
And then he didn't want to use it, but he could actually turn, one of his powers is to turn into an actual vampire because that's part of the legend, but he didn't want to use it because he didn't like the connotation and stuff. He's like, look, I wasn't a fucking vampire. This is some Irishman's bullshit. Please don't make me use this power because it's not fucking me, dog. And then he makes him use the power and he fucking flips the shit.
As it turns out, there is
which I could understand.
There's a lot of contingencies and a lot of lore and a lot of mysticism in pretty much any, as we talked about, Radu the Handsome. It's only maybe mid. There's a lot of fucking...
If he lost the mustache, he looked better.
There's a lot of fucking questions and mysticism and lore as to what actually fucking happened.
Because I'm watching one of the freaking documentaries on this guy, right? And they put up a picture, you know, I'm sorry, a painting of this guy. They put up a painting of that guy. They put up a painting of this guy. And I'm thinking to myself...
Yeah, because photographs didn't fucking exist back then, dude.
Obviously, let me get to the point, please.
How do we know George Washington actually looked like George Washington? You just see paintings of him.
But if you would let me get to my point, then I can figure out what, then you can understand where I'm going with this. So now we're watching these things, and I'm like, all right, these are all paintings. These are artist renderings of these people. They were
hired. Is today the day we break Garrett?
No.
So now fast forward to Rodham the Handsome, and they pop up some fucking guy from 3 days ago that was like a movie star, and I'm like, all right, what's wrong with this picture? Every one of these other motherfuckers look like they're on the back of a Magic the Gathering card, and then they do. They all look like they're the fucking prince of a Magic the Gathering game. And but this guy, he's a fucking movie star. I'm like, how does the most handsome person...
An actual factual person. They took an actual factual picture of... who did we say it was earlier?
I don't fucking know. John Stamos or something? Fucking no.
Yeah, some... a real person. They took a photo of an actual actor, not just like, yeah, this
an
guy looks
cannibal,
like it.
Shia LaBeouf?
Yeah.
An actual predator?
That's another guest I'd love to have on the show. Shia LaBeouf. Oh, man. So, Shia, what does a person actually taste like?
He just bites you. That's his response.
I mean, he's in on the joke. He saw the video with him.
Rob Kantar, thank you. Yeah. I would like to have Rob on as a guest. The guy that made that fucking song.
That would be a good guest.
There's a lot of dream guests.
Jim Norton, I said, is one of mine.
Posty. I'd be cool with Posty.
Oh, Posty would be a fun guest.
Hangs out with a lot of Magic the Gathering channels. I think that's where he got his
Timmy
magic.
Timmy from Whitest Kids You Know.
I think anyone from Whitest Kids You Know, not just Timmy. Any of the living guys, anyway. Rest in peace.
Dude, every time anytime a Reddit question asked what celebrity death was like the one that affected you, I'm like, fucking Trevor. Like, that was, like, the first celebrity death where I actually went, oh, shit. Like, every other one, it's like, oh, all right, yeah, they're a celebrity. Of course, it came with the territory. But this one was like, oh, wow. Huh. Anyway, carrying on.
What about Betty?
She was 99 years old. I knew she was going
to... She should have been 100.
I like that she let the 100-year-old thing come out and then die before she...
She should have been 100.
God, I think Adam West kind of upset me a little bit because I do like classic Batman.
Saget?
Saget was a little upsetting because he was kind of young. Still, it was a bit unexpected. But I think in terms of like actually made me emotionally upset, I think Trevor is like the first one to actually do that. But
I don't think I've ever gotten emotionally upset because an actor, an actress, or somebody's died.
Well, because
somebody, just a somebody has died.
No, some actress or actor or
athlete. Oh, okay.
Somebody like that.
I mean, I wasn't like crying about it, but I was like, you know.
Oh, this sucks.
Yeah, like I was like legitimately like, oh fuck, this really sucks. Like, because, you know, we grew up with like Trevor, like with Whitest Kids You Know, like we watched that shit on fucking repeat.
I don't know.
It's an old sketch comedy show. Whatever. It's a...
It would not be approved of by today.
No. Oh, man. And he was still pushing the envelope with this shit, even like he was making fucking...
Giddy history. Just like ours.
The fucking What About Mouthwash song? Like, just, you know, literally just, hey, drink mouthwash and huff paint to get fucked up.
There's the What About Crystal, How to Make Crystal Meth song.
Oh, yeah, don't. Yeah. Don't teach cheat on your test. Don't think cheat on your test. Yeah. That's how you get sent to the principal. Never mix. I died on something.
Who would you like to see as a celebrity guest? Let's try and do some shout outs and hopefully somebody responds to us at some point and be like, hey, at person, come be a guest.
I already gave two.
Yeah, I know you. I'm asking Garrett, the guy in the middle, who has barely spoken today.
Celebrity guest for you guys.
I think he's just upset.
Well, it's because we keep trying to, like, whatever. Anyway, carrying on. So, yeah, who's, like, a guest you really want?
I think, let's see. Who would be fun?
Sean was cool. Carl was cool. They're probably the most celebrity we've had so far. They're cool. I would love to have them back on. I would love to have any of our guests back on.
Oh, yeah. Try and invite them more. Like, Joe's, like, waiting for, like, a proper invite.
Yeah, Joe wants to get back on. He's been saying
it. He is more than welcome to come on to any episode he wants
to. Joe, if you're watching.
Why?
I've told him flat out, like, Joey, can you see me? Hit us up. Like, just give us a day. We'll have you on, man. Or, you know, give us a day. Yeah, give us a subject. Celebrity guest. Anyway,
Celebrity guest, I think, would be fun to interview.
Or just bullshit with the topic.
Yeah. The Garo guy that from Anime NYC is one of mine now.
I don't know.
Chris Lucia.
Andrew Schultz. He's a funny guy. I'd fucking like Andrew Schultz, comedian, podcaster.
That guy.
He's funny.
Okay.
He'd be fun.
I'm going to tag a couple of these people.
Go right ahead.
I think talking to Tom Green would be fun.
Is that Tom guy still alive? Green?
That guy's still alive?
Freddy Got Fingered guy?
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure he's definitely still alive.
That guy was funny. That guy was funny. And
that movie was what?
That guy.
That was a movie.
And he was dedicated to his craft. That guy was good.
Andrew Kaufman would have been cool if he was still alive.
Yeah.
He was dedicated.
Yeah, he's still kicking.
Tom Green. Andrew Schultz. Come on. Come bullshit about a topic with us.
Come talk to us.
Yeah. We'll make it easy for you.
He was married to Drew Barrymore?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
We'll make it easy for you. We can call in.
He had a cool fucker. He did some cool ass shit.
I'll send you a link. Drop an email.
Huh.
Tom Green show was fucking popular.
Who has Drew Barrymore? She's been married to a few people, hasn't she? Let's see.
At least Tom Green.
Jeremy Thomas, Tom Green, Will Koberman, Fabrizio Moretti, and there's no fucking way she's not fucked Adam Sandler.
Oh, she's definitely fucked Adam Sandler.
They have fucked.
You think Jennifer Aniston's fucked Adam Sandler, too?
Because
she's been in a lot of this shit, too.
She might be out of his league.
I mean, yeah. But I also think Drew Barrymore's out of his league.
No, yeah, but they don't have each other. They don't have the chemistry like Drew and Sandler.
But they've been together for a long time. Drew Barrymore and Adam Sandler, those two came up together.
But the chemistry they have, with the chemistry they work with, they definitely fucked. Him and Jennifer Aniston, they work together. But they don't have that chemistry that says they fucked.
Yeah.
There's a difference. Yeah. There's a they fucked chemistry, and then there's a they work good together chemistry.
Drew
Barrymore have the they fucked chemistry. Yeah. Just like I'm pretty sure she might have fucked
I haven't seen a lot of the Jennifer Aniston, who's the guy Adam Sandler shit.
He's one of my favorite actors, too. The guy who did...
How did we get onto this topic from Vlad?
Fuck. The guy who played from Justified. Timothy Oliphant. I don't think she fucked him, but I definitely think
who's she?
Drew Barrymore, because they co-starred in...
Who?
Timothy Oliphant. He played,
he's an actor.
I don't know.
He played Agent 47 in the first Hitman movie.
Please, like, he's seen that.
He was the guy from Justified.
Nope. He wouldn't have seen that. I can tell you right now, he would have seen...
the West in Rango.
He wouldn't have seen anything that you are mentioning.
Nope.
For fuck's sake, he's a good actor. Anyway.
We digress.
What porn was he in? I was fucking red.
I think he did a thing with Riley Reid.
All right. Yeah, I saw that.
Honestly, I would love to have a porn star on.
Was it called?
I think that I don't care if it's fucking Johnny Sins. I think it would be awesome to have somebody on.
Johnny Sins would be an interesting fucking...
James Dean, Johnny Sims.
No, James.
What happened with that guy? What do you think? Jeremy's got any time right now?
He apparently has some rape allegations.
Also Ron Jeremy, yeah. too.
Oh, yeah. But
okay, any non-canceled fucking porn star want to come on? Let's fucking
have Alexis one. Texas.
Alexis Texas.
She's still a person. Mia Khalifa's doing a lot.
Yeah.
You know, she was actually, she actually did like a whole weekend at one of the strip clubs, I think in Syosset.
Yeah, yeah.
When I was visiting here one year, and I was like, why am I not going while I'm up here?
Yeah, she was on.
Because you didn't have a podcast to promote and be like, hey, come on.
Hey, well, your titties are in my face. Do you want to be on? Yo, imagine getting her for her.
Do you want to be on my podcast? Ask me about my podcast.
Hey, I'm a white guy in his 30s. I got a podcast like every other white guy in his 30s. You want to be on it?
Good night, people. Are we ending it? Anyway. Good night, people.